With the latest version of Revit, Revit 2024, we have some new templates, and they are an improvement compared to the ones that we had previously. Obviously, they cannot compare to the Balkan Architect templates, which you can find by following the link up in the cards above. However, they are worth exploring, and that's what we're going to be doing in today's video. I'm going to be showing you how to use these templates. They can be a little bit confusing and intimidating, especially for beginners, and then more importantly, I'm going to be showing you how you can actually customize them so they can fit your project needs a little bit better. And if you want to check out that whole tutorial on all of the new features of Revit 2024, I'm going to also link that up in the cards above. So let's go. And of course, before we jump into Revit, I would just like to ask you to check out my website, balkanarchitect.com. I'm going to link it up just below this video in the description and then also up in the cards above. That's where you can find all of my Revit courses, where I take the extra time to go slowly, step by step, and explore all of Revit's interesting topics in depth. Okay, so now without any further ado, let's jump straight into Revit. And here we are in Revit, and let me first show you how you actually use these templates. So when you start a new project, here what you'll see is you have to choose a template file, and by default with the new version of Revit you have Imperial Multidiscipline and Metric Multidiscipline templates. Now this doesn't mean that we don't have the old templates, we still have them. However, you have to go here to the Browse button, it's going to open up a menu, and now here you can see the rest of the templates, and this is quite similar to what we've had before. I'm just going to cancel out of this, and I'm going to choose the Metric Multidiscipline template, and let's open it up. The first thing that you're going to notice here is that our level one looks a lot different than it did before. First, here we have a couple of reference planes, so they just mark kind of the center of the project, the internal origin. And then here we have a couple of scope boxes. Well, you can see one scope box, the other one is used to crop the view. So if I open up the default 3D view, here you can see we have these two scope boxes, and it's really important to understand what they do. Scope boxes control the scope of your project. Now you have two of them here. The first one, its name is overall views, and then the second one is grids and levels. So let's explore this first one first. So what they'll do now is go here to level one architecture, and you're going to notice that here, if I want to control the crop of this view, if I try to move this, it's not going to move, it's not going to stretch. That's because the view crop is controlled by the scope box. So if nothing is selected in the view and we go to the properties panel and scroll down a little bit to extents, you will see that the crop view is grayed out, so we can't even click on it, and everything is controlled by this scope box here called views overall. So it's all controlled with this. So all of the views are cropped according to this scope box. So if you change this scope box, you're basically changing the crop of all views. And you're going to notice if I extend one side here in the 3D view, if I go back here, now you can see it extended on that side. So that's basically how this scope box works. Now you can also adjust these scope boxes in a plan view. If you go here to the project browser, we have this coordination section. And here, if you open up one of the floor plans, you can see here they're not cropping the view, and you can actually adjust them here. Okay, so having explained the outer one, let's see what does the inner one do. So the inner one controls the extents of all of your grids and levels. For example, if I go here to the 3D view, you can see we have these two levels in our 3D view, and they're controlled by this scope box. So if I move this scope box in here and here, or if I extend it, the levels are going to stretch with it. So that's just something to keep in mind how it works. I'm just going to go back a few steps just to get it to where it was. Okay, so once we have this in place now, let's now explore how does this affect our grids. So if you go back into level one, and if you decide to place some grids, so I'm just going to place a couple of grids here, When you place the grids, and it doesn't matter really how you place them, you can select them and then you can assign a scope box to those grids. And here, if I set this up to the grids and levels scope box, which is something that you should really do when you create new grids, now you can see they are just kind of to the extents of this inner scope box. And now if we move this scope box and if we adjust it, the grids will move with it. So it's a really nice way to control this kind of project-wide control the project-wide scope of our, well, project. So anyways, let's now go back and we can even get rid of our grids. So that's basically how these two work. If you don't like it, you can delete them or you can just go to the view and you can set the scope box to none. And now you can adjust the crop of the view just like you would previously or regularly. So that's basically how this works. I'm just going to check this back so it's set to scope box overall views. Now, something else that you're going to notice is quite different is the project browser. So here, this being a multi-discipline template, it means that it's well made for multiple disciplines, and those are divided here in the project browser. So if I collapse all of these main menus, you're going to see that we have multiple categories here. So we have our architecture, coordination, electrical, mechanical, plumbing, and structural. Now, it looks like this because here in the views, if I right-click and open up Project Browser Organization, you can see that this has been set up according to the discipline. So for each view, like this floor plan view here, in the properties or in the view properties, you have the option to set up the discipline. And in this case, this is set to architectural. Because this is set to architectural, Revit is going to basically sort this view in the architectural set of views. And then if I expand architectural, here we have our floor plans, site plans, ceiling plans, elevation sections, and any other views that you create, they're going to be sorted out here. This 3D view that we have here, the discipline is set to coordination. If I change it to architectural and hit apply, now here we have 3D views in architecture, and this is the active view that we're in. So that's basically how the project browser works. Now it's set up this way so you can basically work in all disciplines inside of one template, inside of one project. Now this can also be a little bit confusing because you're not going to be able to edit everything in each view type. So let me demonstrate. So here I am in the level one architecture view, and now I'm just going to be placing some walls in this view. Let's just create a small rectangle out of these walls. Now, if I go to my project browser, scroll down to, let's say, electrical, expand that, find the floor plans, and open up the level one floor plan, you're going to notice that we can't really edit our walls here. So walls are considered architectural elements, and they're not going to be available for editing in the electrical floor plans. Now, the reason behind this is because of the electrical discipline. So when we set our view to the electrical discipline or mechanical discipline, architectural elements are going to appear as halftone. Now, we still cannot select them because here in the selection menu, underlay elements are unchecked. So now if I just check the underlay elements, I can start selecting these objects. So you have that ability. So this is something that you just want to keep in mind. If you want to edit for some reason the walls from the electrical plans, just make sure you check the select underlay elements, and now that will be available. Now, if we continue exploring the project browser, you're going to notice that we have some legends already there. So we have some symbols, which is nice, which we can use just to explain which symbol is used for what thing. Then we have some text and dimensions, and something to notice here is that for text and for dimensions, there's a new font, the Trebuchet MS. Now, I'm not a big fan of this font, however, the numbers are quite narrow, which can come in really useful when it comes to dimensioning a project that has a lot of dimensions. Everything is kind of together, so it can just take up a little less space, which is nice. Moving forward, we have some basic basic schedules. Now for schedules, we have the typical ones, so a door schedule, which is quite extensive, as you can see from all the fields. We then have a room finish schedule, sheet index schedule, and a window schedule. So all of this is available. Then we have some working schedules, like a level schedule, structural column schedule, so on and so forth. And then we have a few more over here. Finally, we have sheets. Now, this is also really useful because you have sheets for pretty much everything. So for example, here for our floor plan, we have a sheet set with that, and then we have, well, sheets for pretty much everything else. Now for these sheets, I would like to take a few moments just to explain how you can modify them a little bit. So first, here you're going to notice that we have some data appearing here on the title block, and you might be thinking, well, where can I change this data? Well, one way is just to click here and change the project number, date, and so on. The second approach would be to select it and go to the properties, and here you can change some of these parameters. So the sheet issue date, drawn by, checked by, designed by, approved by, so on and so forth. But some of these, like the client name and then the project name, well, you cannot edit that here in the properties. You can edit it, of course, here if you type it, or alternatively, you can go to the Manage tab and then go to Project Information, open that up, and then here, if you scroll down to Other, here you can change that, and it's going to now appear on all of your title blocks, which I find really useful. So if you want to make changes to that, you can. And also, it makes sense to adjust this title block at least a little bit. I don't like the Autodesk logo, so what I'm going to do is go here to edit type. It's going to open up that, and I can just simply delete that logo and put in my own. I'll just drag it over here on screen, place it there, and there we go. So we have our Balkan Architect logo here. I can load that into the project, override the existing version, and now I have my own logo on the title block. So that's something worth exploring. Now, speaking of customization, something that I find tremendously important to customize is here on the View tab, we have the View Templates. So you can manage your View Templates and then you can make adjustments. So basically, View Templates are kind of presets for your views. So you can go here and you can adjust the view scales, the detail level, parts visibility, visibility, graphics overrides. So you basically customize everything, even the view range and lighting. So if you want to make sure that lighting is up to your preference, you set everything up here. And then once you open up a view that you're working on, so let's actually go with our architectural level one view. So you can just go here, scroll down to view template, open that up, and then you can just assign all of those parameters like that. So now it's going to just apply all of those settings. So this is something that's definitely worth exploring and adjusting. Also for filters, you actually get a fair bit of filters here. So you can see this is everything that you get with a project. I suggest exploring all of these and see how they affect things. But this is something that you can also customize for future projects. Moving forward, something that you want to definitely customize on your template is going to be the families. So you have two types of families. You have the component families, and then you have your system families. So system families would be walls, roofs, ceilings, floors, ramps, railings, stairs, and so on. So these are the families which are here in the project, and you cannot save them as a separate file. The second type of families are the component families. So these would be your doors, windows, columns, and so on. So for these, you can save them as separate files. Now, if you have component families, you can simply open up a folder with those families and you can just drag them over into this project and they will be loaded in. However, the system families are a little bit more complicated. So a couple of approaches would be to, well, for both approaches, you want to open up an existing project that already has some of those system families. So in this case, I've opened up this office building project that they have, and now let's say that I want to steal or grab some of these families from this existing project and then place them in my template. So one approach would be just to select the family in the project. So as long as it's placed like this wall here, I can just go to Control C to copy. I can go back into this project, Control V to paste. It's going to tell me that here it's going to override some materials. That's okay with me. And now I can just place it here. And in this case, it's not visible in this view, perhaps in the 3D view. Yes, it is. There we go. So it's visible in the 3D view. But more importantly, once I delete this element, even though it's deleted, when I go to walls, I will have that wall. So it should be here. Okay, structural exterior wall, 500 millimeter. This is a wall from that project. And now it's always going to be in this template and I can use it. A second approach, what you can do is you can just come back to our template project, go to manage, and then here we have the option to, let's see, transfer project standards. Now, once you open this up, basically you just want to copy from, and then you set that project up. It just has to be opened in Revit at the time. And you just check, select that project. You can go here to check none, and then you can just say, okay, I want to transfer all of the wall types, or I want to transfer all of the text types, and so on and so forth. And then you just click OK, and it's going to transfer everything from those categories from that project into this project. And it's a good way to get a lot of families into your projects quickly. Now, of course, you don't want to overdo it. So if you don't like some families, please remove them, and you can remove them from the project by going again to the Manage tab. And then here we have Purge Unused, and then you can find the families that you don't want. So for example, I can go here to walls, basic walls, and I can say, okay, I don't want a certain family from here. So I can say, I don't want my structural exterior wall. I can just go here to check none, check only that wall, click OK, and now it's purged from our project. Okay, so that kind of concludes bringing in families and removing the families that you don't want. Now, how do we actually save this template and use it later on? Well, to save the template, I first like to delete everything that I don't need. So in this case, and let me close this project, yeah. Okay, so in this case, I don't really have any building elements inside. I'm happy with that. The next step is going to be to go to File, Save As, and then you can save it as a template. Now, you can save it here among your templates. I'm just going to save this on my desktop, Test Custom Template, and then I can simply hit Save. So now that template is being saved. And now in the future, when I want to use it, I can just close this up. I can go here to New, and I can go to Browse, go to my desktop, and then here I'll have that template. And now if I click Open, it's going to open up that particular template. If you want that template to appear over here with kind of the main templates, what you can do is you can simply go here to this little button to go to the File menu, Options, and then here you have File Locations, and this is where you have your templates. So you can just add a button here, go to Desktop, set this template up, and now you have that test template there. Click OK. And now if we go back, click on New, you're going to see that we have that template appearing over here, and now we can use it for our next projects. And there you go. That's how you can use the new multidiscipline template. That's how you can customize it for your particular project needs, and then how you can use it. I hope you have enjoyed this video. If you want to get access to all of my Revit project files, for example, like that office building file that I have shown you, you can find all of those on my Patreon page, which I'm going to link up just below this video in the description, and then also up in the cards above. Thank you for watching, guys. Make sure to check out my website, balkanarchitect.com, for more Revit courses. There I have over 120 hours of content, and I'm adding more each week. Make sure to subscribe for more videos, and also I've added a video over there that might interest you as well.